The film, the hypothesis. Oh, okay. The film, the hypothesis of the stolen painting, along with Pierre Zucca's film Robert, introduces Pierre Klossowski's thought into cinema. The film summarizes to a large extent the main themes that form the philosopher's work. Further, it combines his key philosophical concepts with a close study upon Klossowski's uses of the tableau vivant. The film, which changed several cinematic genres, such as the documentary and the film essay, could be characterized as a cinematic monograph on Pierre Klossowski by Raoul Ruiz. The filmmaker has applied what he has called the combinatory logic in constructing a film of Klossowskian occurrences. The filming method implies a combinatory system of multiple themes that add up to the film's original story. Ruiz produces an endless spiral of images inside images. Having as a starting point the representations of Klossowskian themes in paintings, we come across to a series of tableaux vivants, as well as to a Roman Acle, which in turn is being reconstructed into a tableau vivant. We are witnesses to a film mirror where an endless mise-en-abîme is produced. The filming construction is based upon the personal mythology of Pierre Klossowski. Diane and Achteon, you can see here the tableau vivant by Pierre Klossowski and the representation in the film. The Crusaders, a constant theme in Klossowski's thematology, and the immortal adolescent, and the Roman Acle, the reconstruction of the Roman Acle in the film. Ruiz explicitly manipulates those themes in order to construct a phenomenally original, realistic story. The film can be characterized as an intellectual detective mystery story. A collector has gathered together six paintings by the 19th century painter Frédéric Donner that caused a scandal at the time and consequently have been confiscated by the police. His main preoccupation is to discover what has happened to the seventh painting. The main character is aided by a bodiless voice, that of the narrator, which appears and disappears during the narration. Although that we are not provided with further information on that voice, I might argue that it is a reference to Klossowski's theological themes, a spirit or a demon that frequently appears in the author's novels. The collector presents his investigatory method orally through a series of syllogisms that interact with the recreation of the paintings in the form of tableau vivant in the physical space of the film. The investigation will lead to the revelation of the scandal, the practice of an occult ceremony by a secret society. The diegesis of the film is entirely concentrated on the space of the house. The narration takes place inside its confined limits, except for the opening shot, which is a medium shot of a Parisian road in which the house of the story is situated. The 19th century bourgeois house is an additional character to the narration in the sense that the attributes of the house, such as the living room, the corridors, the rooms, and the garden, contribute both to the masking and to the unraveling of the mystery that surrounds Tonnerre's paintings. The set is a demonstration of Ruiz's theory of a corpus of visual opinions, which are defined as the automatic sequences of images touched off by the first arbitrary image created on the basis of the abstract stimulus. An example of visual opinion is presented by the filmmaker in the following quote. When we go into an unknown house, we see the living room, and on that basis, along with our impressions of the external aspect of the house, we develop an opinion about the rest. The impression of confinement that the house creates to the viewer produces the idea of a space which is induced with a multiplicity of possibilities. I am arguing that the concept of the house as character follows in many respects the Gothic story house. The large spaces, the long corridors, and the unknown that surrounds its spaces is reminiscent of the Gothic house. The black and white cinematography contributes to the mystery that surrounds both the house and the narration. In fact, those two are interlinked to a large extent, since the collector is conducting his investigation according to the settings of the tableau vivant that are organized systematically in the space of the house. That leads me to characterize the hypothesis of the stalling painting as a weak law film. In this kind of genre film, the characters that are presented are isolated from the exterior world. The way the diegesis takes place enables me to speak of a setting that constructs its own private geography. I am arguing that the geography of the house is that which enables the collector to explore further the mystery of the story. We can perceive the different parts of the house as different layers of meaning and as isolated fragments as well. Each fragment corresponds to a tableau vivant, attributing a different meaning to the investigation. Every tableau vivant exists on its own and at the same time is linked to every new one that we see as the narration goes on. As I shall demonstrate later on, the tableaux vivants are fragments of an ultimate tableau vivant that does not exist in the physical space, but it is performed as a virtual image. The collector's and the narrator's investigation is that which associates all of the tableau vivant together. The collector's movement in space is at the same time the unraveling of the story, of the mystery. That process takes place through the body of the collector in the house. Investigation and movement proceed together. The collector's body links together both physically and virtually the space of the film. As Bernard has mentioned, the body links together the fragments in various ways. By its displacement, the body forms a movement and in a relative layout of space in relation to this movement. Along with the displacement of the collector's body in space, the narration proceeds, and as the exploration of the house continues, all the more we come across to different gestures in the spaces of the house. If the Wicklow film has an inherent theatricality due to the enclosed space that is represented in the film, the use of the tableau vivant doubles the theatricality of the film. Tableau vivant as a practice reached their peak during the 19th century. I have to give some historical information that are very much linked to the film. And the adjective vivant refers to the use of bodies in order to construct literally a living painting. A related Latin variation of the adjective is the word vivarium, a noun that refers to a place used for scientific study. Both the words meaning are applicable in the particular study that takes place in the film. The tableaux vivants have been situated in space as actual representations of the paintings that have been confiscated by the police as part of a scandal. The thorough scientific study and the collector's method of aporetic thinking affirms the aforementioned thesis, which is that the tableaux vivants becomes a space of interpretation and investigation. In his book, Ruiz argued that the recreation of a scene with living bodies is an attempt to recreate the original poses of the original models that posed for the painter. To reconstruct a scene is to be able to capture the tension of the original pose. That is to be able to reincarnate the physical tension of the first models. The reincarnation of the original gestures is the reincarnation of the original tension, argues Ruiz. Apart from the physical tension that Ruiz spoke of, tableaux vivants are a representation of an original and or supposedly original painting that aim to concentrate on details such as lightning and shade. With its neoclassical aesthetic, that kind of technique has the quality and the ability to reproduce with living bodies a painting. But its performance is not just as to exist just as a copy. Its realization is an act of imitation. And Michel Godard has pointed out that this activity of the 19th century salon can be understood as a highly perverse reproductive technique that instead of making an original non-exchangeable through the multiplication of copies, would render it absolutely singular through its corporeal actualization in living material. The singularity of every tableau vivant in its fragmentary representation lies in its fragmentary representation in time and space. It is a mute representation of a painting that is being performed whilst it empowers the effects of the original. Here I'm opening a small parenthesis. show a photograph of Tableaux Vivants of the 19th century. And Tableaux Vivants, which has been used in cinema after Ruiz, because Godard has been inspired by the film Hypothesis of the Stolen Painting. It's a common practice of Godard when a new idea comes up into cinema to take it and create something on his own. And here we see again how the Tableau Vivant, Goya, it's a representation of Goya, we see again how in cinema, how the poses of the bodies and how with the camera, the artificiality and the lightning, how that contributes to the overall effect of the Tableau Vivant in cinema. Now I will go to the Tableau Vivant designates a space. I'm going back to Klossowski now. The Tableau Vivant designates a space which I would characterize as an image in suspension. Klossowskian images are temporal and spatial. The essence of Klossowskian temporality lies in the ephemeral aspect of the tableau. That occurs since the scenes that are depicted have either a theological and mystical aspect or an erotic one that is presented in a theatrical way. According to Alain Arnault, the tableau can exist only through the complicity of the spectator's gaze, since they are intense and decisive, but at the same time are fugitive and elusive. The fortuitous moment reveals the Tableau Vivant to the gaze. In that particular moment of the gaze, space transforms into a situation that implicates the viewer, making him, her, an accomplice. The space of the Tableau Vivant exists as a host for the fugitive gaze. Klossowski argues that the corporeal space that reproduces in its silence that impenetrable gesture suggests other possible gestures and contradictions. Time, space, and vision become interlinked in the moment of the gaze. Time and space possess the gaze in the space that is being opened. The image in suspension is an ephemeral spatio-temporal reality that reveals itself through its becoming simulacrum. The in-between space, the theatrical aesthetics, and the representation of the painting, that is the Tableau Vivant, announces in the film the spatial presence of the simulacrum. The first characteristic of the Tableau Vivant is the mutism of the bodies with its contradictions, as well as the non-communicable meaning that the gestures allude. The second characteristic that encloses the first one in this function of vision is the simulacrum. According to the philosopher, the simulacrum as an imitative action is the actualization of something that rests non-communicable in itself or non-representable, that is strictly the fantasy in its obsessional constraint. In other words, the simulacrum imitates the fantasy that erupts. Arnault again points out that Klossowski's use of the simulacra is being done clearly in order to translate in a spatial and touchable way the figures that live in his mental universe, concluding that Klossowskian eroticism is a method, a style, more than being an exposure of the obsessions and fantasies of an erotomaniac. The Klossowskian method that Ruiz adopts is encompassed in the use of the Tableau Vivant as simulacra. The structure of the hypothesis of the stolen painting is based upon the infinite reproduction of meaning, since each simulacrum Tableau Vivant leads to another without particular aim or goal. Even if on the surface the collector's syllogisms seem rational, or if as an intellectual strategy produce meaning, Ruiz turns into parody those kinds of syllogism. It is the conception of a false infinite, as Gilles Deleuze has called it, that simulacra form in the constructed images. The philosopher defines their attributes as follows. In virtue of their speed, which causes them to be and to act below the sensible minimum, simulacra produce the mirrors of a false infinite in the images which they form. It is particularly with the third and swiftest species, the phantasms, that one witnesses the development of the illusion and the myth which accompany it. In a mixture of theology, eroticism, and onirism, amorous desire possesses only those simulacra which lead it to the known bitterness and torment, even into the pleasure which it wishes were infinite. The spatial presence of the simulacra is being performed by the tableau vivant, as we have seen. It is through the gesturality of the living bodies that the collector and the acousmatic voice aim to derive meanings and interpretations of the painting. As the investigation proceeds, the collector focuses all the more on the gestures of the bodies. The gesturality of the bodies produces the spiral of the false infinite that is being reproduced in every image in the film. As the collector mentions in the form of a conclusion, the same gestures repeated from painting to painting. That is what the investigation of the collector seeks through the representation of the paintings is the gestures of the bodies, and more precisely, the reconstruction of the ritual. The dramaturgy of the gestures gathers together the composition of the ritual. Arnaud states that this occurrence is due to the fact that gestures are attributed with a different value from what they represent. The bodies of the models are placed in space in a silent mode, and through their gesture they imply contradictory meanings. Klossowski, according to Klossowski, motionless gestures which are suspended in space provide material for a narration that is on its own eternal and inaccessible and without ever having a decisive interpretation. The gestures of the bodies present a constant ambiguousness, the form of an image that implies other images and thus creating other images ad infinitum. Further, the gestures of every figure in the film link all the tableau vivant together in an uninterrupted whole that is composed of fragments. The silence of the tableau vivant and their mute gesturing are the true objects of the collector's investigation. As we can observe from the above, the collector interprets, or better, presents one of the possible interpretations of the bodily gestures. In this obscure narration that constantly escapes one possible interpretation, language and silence coexist. Ruiz constructs a play between visibility and invisibility. The visibility of the bodies and the invisibility of the inaccessible that lies in the simulacra images. This association of the gaze with speech acquires the quality of the essential relation, which consists of the complicity of sight and speech, as Deleuze has mentioned. This complicity must be understood here as a disjunction between body and language. First and foremost, it is the language of the bodies that guides the syllogism that are heard aloud in the film. The fact that bodies have a language of their own is essentially defined by the use of gestures, and that is the function of the simulacra. They encompass the phantasm that language seeks to define. Deleuze again describes the process of flexion. The body is language because it is essentially flexion. In reflection, the corporeal flexion seems to be divided, split in two, opposed to itself and reflected in itself. It appears finally for itself, liberated from everything that ordinarily conceals it. In this sense, it is the bodies that reflect the intentions upon language. The collector forms his syllogism upon the reflection of the bodies. His language, then, is the reflected intentionality of the gestures. And the final chapter of this presentation, Circulus Vitoosus Deus, or the virtual image. Now, as we approach to the final phase of the film, the collector informs us that the stolen paintings does not exist. The collector traced the occult theme that lies hidden in all of the paintings, and Ruiz's camera movement has performed a virtual circle that led from one painting to the next inside the space of the house. The paintings are compared to circles that altogether lead to the sphere, Baphomet. In fact, the collector has recreated the ceremony for the film. The paintings are the ceremony. Each gesture of the bodies in the tableau vivant is part of the ceremony. In Klossowskian terminology, the ceremony is the Nietzschean reenactment of the concept of the eternal return. The virtual circles that have been produced in the film are singularities whose actualized intentionality forms the idea of the whole as it is represented in the film. At the end, what we see is a synthesis of the different singular gestures of all the tableau vivant that are represented in the film. The protagonists of the different paintings Tableau Vivant are being unified in a sort of spatial osmosis. Diane and the Crusaders, the characters from the Roman Clé, all become one by their placement in the same space. The fragment's singularities, which are the circles, are now an actual visualization of the sphere. As the collector mentions, all that remains are the isolated gestures. Let us let the paintings vanish. That's it. Yep. That's it. Yep. Thank you.